COVID-19 is an illness caused by a coronavirus. Now, coronaviruses are very common respiratory viruses, and they often cause coughs and colds during most winter periods. However, sometimes they develop mutations and they can become much more infectious and have a more severe clinical disease. So coronaviruses were the cause of SARS, they're the cause of MERS, and of course, they're now the cause of COVID-19.
So the symptoms of COVID-19, I mean, they've been progressing as the disease has progressed. So initially we started off with a cough, slight temperature, and you also tend to have less of a dry cough but more of a sore throat. Very much similar to what sometimes you get with flu as well.
Viruses always mutate. That's what viruses do. It's very, very natural. We see that with all types of viruses. Coronavirus does it as well. Actually, it's not as good as mutating as some other viruses that we see. But through this process of mutation, naturally in a human population, we see some of those mutations. They will basically spread more easily from person to person, and potentially also they will cause more severe disease.
So what we see with the variants that we have been observing since the end of 2020, where we had the beta variant, the alpha variant, and more recently the delta variant, is that these are variants which have mutations which make the coronavirus, the wild type coronavirus, far more infectious. It makes it more likely that for those who are infected, you may have a more severe clinical disease. But we also know that with these variants, that the vaccines which we have are effective and therefore are an effective tool in controlling the variants. So we look out for variants because of the possibility of them becoming more transmissible and more severe. But we also have the tools to deal with the variants at the moment, which are the effective vaccines. So very early on, from the first wave of the pandemic, that Black, Asian, and minority ethnic groups were more likely to be tested for COVID, more likely to be diagnosed, more likely to have severe disease, and unfortunately more likely to die.
We made a decision quite early on to try to make sure that obviously the patients in the BAME community got access to the COVID vaccination. There's always been a bit of a reluctance with vaccination in the community. And we wanted to make sure that because of the risk of COVID, especially to people of the BAME community, that they were appropriately vaccinated.
Now, there's no one reason why we see this difference occurring, because it's not the color of your skin that makes that risk, but there are factors which include the trust that you have with the healthcare system, the amount of access that you're able to have with the health and care system, and the confidence that you feel in going to your GP and saying, actually, I'm unwell, I need to be tested, and I need to go to a hospital. It has a lot to do with our social and living conditions. Many Black, Asian, and minority ethnic people were not able to isolate at home because they're key workers. They were going out to take care of us in the city, whether construction workers, nurses, social care staff, teachers. Many of these professions come from Black, Asian, minority ethnic backgrounds.
We also know things like obesity and diabetes and other illnesses that make you more vulnerable to the effects of COVID are more prevalent in these communities.
I think there's something about how we interact socially, so that we have large extended families, we also have large social networks that makes families, if they're not careful, perhaps more prone.
Sometimes the living conditions that we're in, overcrowded housing, living in multi-generational homes, and being in communities which are tightly knit, and you have the risk of transmission within communities. So, you know, we talk about vaccine hesitancy, and I want us all to realize that it is okay to have questions about a new therapy, and it is absolutely okay to have questions about a new disease, how you manage it, and the side effects. And so I always welcome people to ask questions, either of myself, of their doctor, of a health professional who knows about these things, to give proper advice. The challenge that we have is that there's so much misinformation circulating on WhatsApp, in many social media sites, or are propagated by members of our own communities.
I do not want to be subject to an experiment, something that's been rolled out under emergency measures. There's been far too many corners cut, no animal trials testing.
Number one, the technology that was used to develop the vaccine isn't a new technology. It wasn't just developed last year. We have been using that technology to develop other vaccines and to research other vaccines in the past. So what we're able to do is to use that methodology, but apply it to the coronavirus. And then there are three reasons why we were able to move so fast last year. Number one, governments had this as a number one priority. Funding was put into this that accelerated development, and the resources that were needed for very large vaccine trials were available, and that enabled us to learn quickly. Number two, we had hundreds of thousands of people volunteering to be part of the coronavirus vaccine studies. And the third reason why we're able to move fast is that normally after your vaccines are developed, you've gone through your clinical trials, the regulatory process can add years onto that for agencies such as the FDA in the US or the MHRA here in the UK. On this occasion, because we're in a global pandemic, the MHRA worked with the drug companies to go through all of the research and the design phases before it was ready to go through regulatory approval. And they were able to shorten the process of regulatory approval. No lines were crossed, no corners were turned. It was simply that the regulators were working with the developers in order to learn about the vaccine, in order to reduce the time.
But the virus lacks virility. This isn't the virus we were sold. This isn't the virus we were promised.
People who are not experts in health and who have never given a vaccine yet have now an opinion about the vaccine, and that brews mistrust, it brews a lack of confidence, and can drive hesitancy.
The COVID vaccine is now being offered to children between 12 to 15, and they'll be only given one injection. Now, they've done a lot of studies on this in America, where this has been rolled out well before in the UK with the Pfizer vaccine, and they've shown that in all the studies, it's completely safe.
We know that a significant number of infections are in our 16 and 17 year olds as they're in schools, as they're socializing in the community. And as we saw in wave three, most of the infections were in young people for a very long period of time before spreading into older adults and therefore causing harm. So what we really want to do is to ensure we give all our young people the chance to protect themselves from the infection, both for their own well-being, but also to reduce the risk of spreading it to older people who may be unvaccinated or who may be vulnerable.
So children already undergo a vaccination schedule, so they're almost more familiar with the vaccination side of things.
So for example, in my children's school, we have a child who has some sort of health condition and got very low immunity, and they're always sending us little messages saying, do not send your children if they've got minor coughs or colds because of this particular child who can't protect themselves. So this other child has to miss out on school or depend on others being safe around them. And again, this is what this new 12 to 15 year old Pfizer vaccination does, is not only to protect your child, but to protect the community. Protect the community, it has benefits for all of us in the long run.
So I don't want to get the vaccine because I don't feel, I've had two people in my family that have had this vaccine, and about a week later they've had like mild strokes. And I just don't want that. I'm pretty asymptomatic. Like, I've been in a household where everyone in that household has had COVID, and I've had a slight bit of fatigue, but nothing else, literally nothing.
The main issues that people always had with the vaccination were the typical things you get, sort of sore arm, headaches, feverish symptoms. Those were the ones that you'd expect to get with any kind of vaccination program.
The information that we're now having from the immunological studies which are being done suggest that immunity from the vaccine tends to be much stronger than the immunity that you develop from being naturally exposed to the virus. And that's why we encourage everybody to get vaccinated, because it gives you the strongest immune response.
Having the vaccine gives a sort of controlled reaction to the COVID infection. And yes, there might be a small risk of clots, but it really is tiny compared to catching COVID.
And there is a process now. So for example, if you're under the age of 40, we're not giving you the AstraZeneca, but the chances of the clotting is very low in itself. And so it's more for high-risk patients.
So in London, we're doing amazing work with our young people, working with local authorities. And this includes developing a youth panel that provides us advice on what we can actually do to increase uptake and marketing to young people. We have involved young people in developing strategies and plans, which we then fund to engage young people in the vaccination initiatives. And we have trained up a cohort of young vaccine champions, which docks into the health champions initiative that we had for COVID over the past year. So we now have a group of young people who we're training up to be COVID vaccine ambassadors, who will then be able to spread the message in their own communities. Now, about 10 to 13% of people who develop COVID will have long COVID, which are long-standing symptoms of lung disease, fatigue and tiredness and weight loss and headaches as a result of being exposed to the COVID virus.
You see some young people who are normally quite fit and active, maybe run marathons, who can long distance running, and they find it very difficult sometimes to get out of bed or go up and down stairs.
Most people are getting breathlessness. So that's the biggest thing I hear, is that they are getting short of breath where they wouldn't have got short of breath before.
It can have huge implications for patients. It can affect their work life and their family life. The feeling of constant breathlessness can really diminish your quality of life.
And so the vaccines, by reducing your risk of becoming infected and transmitting the virus, is likely to have an impact on long COVID as well. So those are three reasons why young people should get the vaccine when offered.
So the pandemic's had a lot of impact on local people. In terms of the way we've had to change our daily routines, that's put a lot of stress on people. Clearly, we've seen mental well-being being a big factor for a lot of people.
For many people, especially if you're of brown or black ethnic origin, making sure you're having your vitamin D as recommended, because we don't get enough vitamin D. If you are overweight or if you are obese, do speak to your doctor about weight management services and set yourself targets to do more walking, more physical activity. Get your dietary advice so that you can both have a healthy weight, which in turn helps to take care of your physical and mental health. So in addition to taking care of your physical health, it's really important that you do the things that you do to replenish you and to sustain you mentally. See friends, volunteer, be physically active, go out in nature and ensure that you're enjoying the outside spaces, and do the things that replenish your soul. Those are things that we can all do for well-being as well. For older people who have weak immune systems, or for people who are immunocompromised, for those groups especially, a booster dose of the vaccine may be needed to help to bolster your immune system.
Most people had their vaccination quite early in the year, January, February, they had both their doses. And there has been some study that the immunity potentially afterwards can drop off after a period of 6 or 7 months. So just to make sure that people's immunity is boosted to a high level, and to preempt that, the government has asked for patients who had more than 6 months from their second jab and who are particularly high risk, so those people of an elderly group or who've got other medical problems like diabetes, to have a booster jab. Also be aware that winter's coming up as well. So in winter, again, the chance there are people will be indoor, people will be mingling in that community. So chance again picking up COVID are good. So what we're trying to do with the booster jab is make sure that everybody's immunity is at the top level.
So in our work to tackle vaccine hesitancy of the past 9-10 months, we've learned a lot. We've learned a lot about meeting communities where they're at, listening actively to their concerns, and providing the information, whether it is in the appropriate language, whether it's in videos, whether it's in short memes, finding the channels that best work for those communities has also been important.
There's always been a bit of a reluctance with vaccination in the community. And we wanted to make sure that because of the risk of COVID, especially to people of the BAME community, that they were appropriately vaccinated.
We've learned about the importance of using trusted voices for those communities. Now, in some communities, it may have been the imam, in others, it's the priest, in others, it's the local councillor, and in others, it's a DJ artist who plays on a Saturday night.
What we realised really early on was that it was really important to make strong community connections. And so we developed this model of engagement, which we call our Sun Health Champions. And we have worked with the health champions since the start of the pandemic. They have been instrumental in getting our messages out. So we have regular meetings with them. We send them a weekly message. They put the message out on their channels. And they have been really helpful in myth busting in Sutton, in putting stuff on their channels from a trusted source. And it has been a real revelation about how the community comes together and can work brilliantly once you've made those connections.
I just saw one person who was very phobic towards needle, in tears desperately, and just watching how the team comes together to comfort her, reassure her, sits with her through the whole thing, and after 15 minutes gives her biscuits, water, and sends her off on her way, which is an amazing service.
What I think was really important was seeing the natural hesitancy and fear that the majority of age groups had when they were coming to get their vaccine, from the 90-year-olds down to the 50-year-olds, but then seeing how happy they were when they overcame their fears and they actually got it, and how much more comfortable and proud they were that when they got it, they were part of a bigger story, a bigger picture. And then when they came back for their second one, realizing that after their first one, nothing bad had happened. They might have felt a bit tired, had a dodgy arm, but they were so excited to come back and get the second one. And all that fear and hesitancy and anxiety had gone, and they'd become advocates for it. And they were actually helping their fellow people in the queue who might have felt a bit worried because they hadn't had one before.
So I got involved with some of the local mosques to set up the clinics in the community, just to make sure basically that they were done on the weekends in a surrounding that was more suitable and more familiar to them, and just to make sure that we increase the uptake of the vaccination.
Generally, my interactions with patients were really positive. I think a few of them came in feeling slightly anxious, so it was just about kind of calming them down, reassuring them that they're in safe hands with the doctors, and any concerns that they had would be addressed to the full extent.
The patients value the fact that it seems very calm and very organised, so actually their vaccination today is almost a pleasant experience.
And in our work with communities, we talk about adopting a hyper-local approach to vaccination in the city. We started it here in London because we knew we were going to have challenges in this really fantastic, diverse city that we live in. And in doing so, we look at the data at the ward level. So really looking at small neighborhoods, and we're able to both understand the vaccination level in those neighborhoods, to look at variations by age and gender and race ethnicity, and then to map that with information on where the coronavirus infection is occurring. And that allows us to identify all of the communities in London that are most vulnerable because they have low vaccination rates and high coronavirus rates. And therefore, that is where we ensure we go out. We have our outreach vans and buses. We have people knocking on doors. We work with community pharmacies, and we work with local mosques and churches in those communities which are most vulnerable to get those vaccines out.
I'm delighted to be here today at the pop-up clinic, Jubilee Health Centre. And it's fantastic to see so many people here coming for the vaccine, some coming for their first vax, and some coming for their second.
I was a bit nervous, but the staff were very supportive and welcoming, and the vaccinator explained everything to me in a very clear way. So I felt very fine and calm.
I came here because it was the opportunity that was given to me, and I thought that in order to protect myself and my family, I would get the Pfizer vaccine.
It's my first dose, it was just a little sting for about a second, that's it.
I wasn't really nervous before because of my family have already been vaccinated, but it wasn't really painful to get it done. I've not felt any side effects so far. It was just like a little scratch.
I think it's important for young people to be vaccinated because obviously as lockdown's been lifted, more people are out, so it's important to, you know, get your vaccine and, you know, protect yourself and other people.
I'm delighted to be here today in the St. Nicholas Vaccination Centre where they're rolling out the vaccination to 18 and above now this week. And we really appreciate all the hard work that they're doing, all the volunteers, all the NHS staff. We're just coming here to show our appreciation and thanking them for all their hard work. And we just love the operation here. It's really flowing very easy for our residents coming in, registering themselves and coming in and getting the vaccination.
Walked in, was met by someone, signed some forms, came in, was led to the vaccination place. It's just a small prick on the arm, really.
This centre has been here for some 30 years, started by the late Lal Hussein, who also was the mayor of Sutton once upon a time. And it gives us enormous pleasure and satisfaction to be able to take part in the vaccination of the population against the coronavirus.
Side effects kiklu nahi tha to vaccine lewasi my major lidu mar first dose to man khali thoru fever hato and bas thoru kalak hata and pachi it went off so vaccine lewu zaruri cha.
Jab maine pehli vaccine lagwai to mujhe thoda sa bukhar aur kaampna hua ek din ya do din raha. उसके बाद मैं बिल्कुल ठीक फील कर रहा हूँ और ये जो एंटीबॉडीज़ हैं थोड़ा बदने में टाइम लेती हैं और आज दूसरी वैक्सीन लगी है. हो सकता है कि थोड़ा बहुत हो पर कोई उसका फ़र्क नहीं पड़ता क्योंकि मुझे पता है कि मैं अब ये जो हमारा दुश्मन जो दिखता नहीं है हमें उसके अगेंस्ट मैं थोड़ा सेफ़ हूँ. तो मैं बिल्कुल बोलूँगा कि सब लोगों को लगवानी चाहिए ये, जिससे एक सेफ्टी नेट बन जाए और हम लोग एज अ आवाम यूके का अपने आप को सेफ महसूस करें.
हाँ हमें आपने सब दृष्टि आकर्षण कर एक मास आगे एक देर मास आगे पहला वैक्सीन प्रथमवार वैक्सीन टीका नहीं एंड दिस इज सेकेंड टाइम निल आज के प्रथमवार नवर पर हमारे को पार्श्व प्रतिक्रिया छो ना एब्सोल्युटली नॉर्मल छिलाम खूब ही नॉर्मल साधारण छिलाम हमारे को पार्श्व प्रतिक्रिया छो ना जस्ट डे टू डे नॉर्मल.
Bugün camimizde hali hazırda koronavirüs aşısı aşılanmaktadır. Şunu ifade etmek isterim ki British Islamic Medical Association ve The Muslim Council of Britain'a göre aşılarda hiçbir hayvansal ürünün bulunmadığını ve tamamen helal olduğunu ifade etmek isterim. O yüzden size sunulduğu ve söylendiği vakitte gelip aşınızı olmanız sizin için ve toplum için iyi olacaktır. Şimdiden herkese teşekkür ediyorum.
بليز اذا بتقدروا تيجوا تاخذوا الفاكسين يا الفايزر الاسترازينيكا لانه عم نشوف كثير الفيرينتس عم بيطلعوا والناس عم بيدخلوا المستشفيات. اذا اي حدا خايف بليز ارفعوا التليفون بتقدروا تروحوا على الويب سايت تبع ساوث ويست لندن تضربوا على سطن وفي نمر تليفونات احكوني تليفون وبنقدر نكون معاكم وبنخلي الدكتور يحكي معكم بس بليز بليز تاخذوا الفاكسين. شكرا.
So we are in the middle of a pandemic, and it is absolutely clear that almost every country in this world has been touched by the coronavirus pandemic. We have had a particular severe impact in our country, in the UK, and other countries, as they're going through different waves of the pandemic, are being affected too. Now, vaccines are a way to ensure that we can reduce the impact of these waves of infection. And it's important that not only are we having high vaccination rates in our country here in the UK, but that we work with other countries, other less developed countries, to ensure they have access to the vaccines, that they're able to monitor and understand variants of concern in those countries, and that we have the appropriate policies for travel and to support people who need to move between these territories. So vaccine equity and vaccine access globally is as important as it is here in our own country, in the same way that I'm keen to ensure that every community in London has access to the vaccines and that they're encouraged to take it up. I would like to ensure that we're working with countries so that they have plans for vaccine access and they're able to scale it up. It is such a privilege for us in the United Kingdom to have a vaccine and to have access to vaccines that work. And that's why even when I speak to people who are hesitant, I say to them, remember that this is a privilege that we have. There are millions of people, billions of people around the world who don't have access to this vaccine and who, because of the coronavirus, remain at risk. So I think vaccine equity is important for us here at home, but also a responsibility we have for the global community.